This is KPFA 94.1 in Berkeley, KPFB 89.3 in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno at 88.1, and K248BR 97.5 in Santa Cruz, or online at www.kpfa.org. It's 2 o'clock. Time for Pushing Limits.
Keep on pushing. Keep on pushing. I've got to keep on.
Yes, it is 2 o'clock, and it is time for our special Fun Drive edition of Pushing Limits. More on that later, but in the meanwhile, you may have seen ADAPT, the Radical Disability Rights Group, in the news once again, having people, some of them using wheelchairs, being dragged out of these Kavanaugh hearings. But it, of course, ADAPT goes way, way, way farther back than that, to back before there were even lifts on buses. And our guest today, Stephanie Thomas, has been around for most of that ride. Stephanie, are you out there? Not yet, she says.
So that would be someone else telling us that she's not here yet, but she is on our way, and she is a longtime ADAPT organizer. She can tell us, how do you get the most vulnerable, the poorest group of people in the United States to come out and risk life and limb on behalf of us and everyone else in the nation?
Here's Stephanie.
Hello.
Hello, there we go.
Hi, Stephanie.
Thank you for joining us.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
You're quite
so
welcome.
I hear this is your fundraiser, so I want to encourage everyone to donate.
But you haven't seen anything we do yet, Stephanie. Well, that's okay. We'll just do it. Everybody should donate. Exactly. And let's talk about how everyone can donate.
I'm not on mic.
Ah, we're looking for mics for Shelley and Josh, Eric, if you could,
okay,
please.
Okay, in the meanwhile, please give money. I mean, I understand that the station was briefly off the air during the middle of this Kavanaugh fiasco yesterday morning. That this is of concern because old-timers may recall that our sister station, KPFT in Houston, was once blown off the air by right-wing bombers. We hope that this was just a technical glitch, but one never knows around here, and so we need you on our side.
The number to call is 1-800-439-5732. That's 1-800-439-5732. I'm Shelley. I'm here with Mark and Adrienne and Josh, and we're gonna quadruple team you to give us a call or to go online at kpfa.org, because having disability voices on the radio is so important in this dark hour. Mark was talking about the darkness of the station going offline yesterday. We don't want to have our voices stopped in any way, shape, or form in this time that we're in with Mr. Kavanaugh going up against the women, and with us, with ADAPT, standing up for disabled. We need all of you to stand up for KPFA by dialing 1-800-439-5732 or going online to kpfa.org. Let me tell you what we have for you. When you dial in at the $40 level, you can receive one of Helga Spiesman's pussy hats, which is great for all occasions and for everyday wear at this time. If you need a family four-pack, all you need to do is give us $100 and you got four. And if you want to join at the $60 level, you can receive a beautiful My Medicaid Matters t-shirt by ADAPT. It's in red. It's a beautiful red t-shirt. Comes in all sizes. That's $60. And if you want to donate, go up to the $100 level. We've got unapologetically disabled sweatshirts, hooded sweatshirts for you in all different colors. 1-800-439-5732. The important thing is that you call, you support disability radio on KPFA in these times right now. And we do have a match. We have a $200 match. We need to raise at least $200. Our goal this hour is $1,500. But we need the phones to ring so that our match is made. And if you want the whole shebang, the pussy hat, the shirt, and the sweatshirt, donate $150 and they're yours. Adrienne.
You know, watching Kavanaugh, listening to the Kavanaugh hearings, it's so obvious that there are people out there protesting and they're not getting any attention from the mainstream media. People are willing to be arrested day after day of these hearings, and they're not getting the attention. And that's why we thought it was so important to have Stephanie on, because we know in our hearts and in our actions, we know that these kinds of things make a huge difference. And that's partly what we got your gifts for today, because we got you your protest winter wear.
Nice.
So if you've been newly aggravated, newly enraged, or just want to go out there and be with your strong community this winter, well, become a member of KPFA and get some of this gear, and we'll tell you a bunch about how to do that.
1-800-439-5732. We have a caller on the line. Join that caller. Let's make it two. Hey. Let's make it three. Let's make it every dollar counts. $25, you become a voting member of KPFA. $25 is great. 1-800-439-5732. Josh?
We should go to Stephanie pretty quick.
Well, so Josh, we should, but we just got another caller on the line, we're getting it. Josh?
Yeah. You know, no, I will say that I'm honored that I could take a little time out of my own time, my own station time, to be with you and Shelley and Mark, but this is an institution. I've been at this place for, I don't want to say the years, but I respect the work that you all do on pushing limits, and I never say that. But it takes a village it takes phone volunteers to send out.
Exactly.
It takes everybody to make it happen. And we have volunteers on the phone, and we need more volunteers in the phone room. So if you can come down to Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley and volunteer your time, we do need help in the phone room. We have three callers on the line. Yeah. Let's make it more. 1-800-439-5732. And let's get to the show.
Excellent. Well, of course, ADAPT does go back not quite as far as KPFA, but it too is an institution. It's been around since the 80s. So here's Brett Kavanaugh partying it down on the old campus at Yale, where I had just arrived in 83. And out west in Denver, here's Stephanie and a bunch of other ADAPT people making history.
So tell us about that, Stephanie. Yeah. How was that?
Well, you know, it's been a long, windy road, and it has gone back pretty far, gone back to 83. And before that, there was the Atlantis community that helped people break out of a nursing home and move into the community. And then in the early 80s, just a little bit later on, there was the fight for the lifts on buses, and that's what we began with. It's all grassroots work. I mean, if we don't have grassroots, then I don't think we really get the people to move. I think it was one of those protesters at the Kavanaugh hearings today that was able to convince Jeff Flake to go for that push to try to get the our FBI investigations.
That's right.
And I know from many of the actions that I've been at that even though they don't get a lot of coverage in the mainstream news, when the disability community talks about what's going on, it passes the word through our community. It lets people know. Because back in the day before ADAPT really got going, I mean, there were other people doing some protests here and there, but largely the disability community, and I know the the non-disabled community definitely felt like, you know, people's place was kind of quietly in the background, and you know, came to a boiling head that people just felt like it couldn't go on like that anymore, that we belonged in the community, we were part of the community, and it was time for us to be recognized. And that's what really birthed ADAPT and the activism that that we were part of, and it really got the ball rolling for the kind of the grassroots part of the ADA happening, and getting people to really push and feel that they had a right, and they had a right to speak out for it.
So I bet you there's still people out there who think that they're the person they know who uses a wheelchair or has a developmentally disability can't possibly get involved in direct action. It's too scary. It's too life threatening, even. And you started by saying we want lifts on the buses. We want to ride the buses. I bet you there's people out there who don't even realize there was a time that people with disabilities couldn't get on the buses. But how did you, either you personally or you and your immediate group, how did that play out? Like, we're going to stop a bus. Whoa.
Well, I wasn't there in the very, very, very beginning, but what happened was is that in Denver, the people there, when they got out of the nursing home, they couldn't really get around the community because there wasn't really curb cuts and there wasn't really transportation. So, you know, you're kind of picking your way from driveway to driveway at best. And they said, this is not right. You know, we're paying taxes. We're part of the community. We deserve to be able to use the public stuff. There's a musician from England named Johnny Crescendo, and he has a really great song called Fixed Penalty Rights, and there's a line in it that says it's all, sometimes you might know it as access, and yet there's a line in it that says, when you say public, you only mean you. Well, we're members of the public and we've got rights too. And that was kind of the thinking of the people who were learning from the civil rights movement, from the women's movement, and a lot of the other social change that was going on at that time. And they were saying, you know, why not disabled people? And they had gone to the transit authority quite a few times to talk to them about the need for lifts on buses, and they were just blown off time after time. I'm sure you're all familiar with the head pats you can get as a disabled person suggesting something. And even if they're not literal head pats, the kind that you get when people go, thank you very much, you know, for your testimony, and don't let the door hit you in the butt. So I people felt like they had to do something very dramatic to get the attention of the politicians. And the decision was to go down to Broadway and Colfax in downtown Denver and surround a bus and hold it until the head of the transit authority agreed to negotiate in earnest. And so that's what they did. And actually, their congressional representative, Pat Schroeder, was one of the people that came down to support them. She brought them coffee and donuts, and people were, you know, a lot of the public was really supportive. And the politicians and the police were kind of like stymied. They had never seen anything like that. They'd never seen a disabled person acting out. And they felt like, you know, this is just too bizarre. And it eventually, after an overnight stay in the streets around the bus, they wound up being able to convince the transit people, and the mayor came down on their side, Mayor Pena, and said, you have to negotiate. And so then they began to negotiate in earnest for lifts on the buses.
Excellent.
And I got in, and it was brilliant. And when I was in college, there was no public transit. I had an accident shortly before I went to college, and there was no public transit at all. There was no way to get around. There wasn't paratransit really. And there was probably some medical transport services, but those were for medical purposes. And there was just no way to get around. And I was totally frustrated. Before that, I had used public transit all the time, and I didn't even want to get a driver's license. And now, all of a sudden, there was no option for me, and it infuriated me. And so, I was out of college by the time I heard about ADAPT, but I immediately was attracted, because here were people addressing a real issue for people who had no other way to get around.
And you've mentioned nursing homes a couple of times. What does that have to do with disability? Aren't nursing homes for elderly people?
Well, back in the day, that was kind of the only option for people who needed attendant services, unless your family was willing to do it. There really were almost no programs available for people. And so what actually birthed ADAPT was an organization called the Atlantis Community, which was started by a gentleman named Wade Blank, who worked as an orderly in a nursing home and then got promoted to social director. And when he was asked to recruit young people to move into this nursing home with him, there's a made-for-TV movie about it called When You Remember Me. And when they started to get together and talk with him, and when he got some younger people to come to the nursing home, the idea was that they were going to have a more normal life. But when they began to expand their thinking and realize that they were really being given a chance, because you know what happens is, it's like when you I don't know if you've heard about these experiments where they squeeze a mouse and the mouse doesn't fight back, and after a while,
that's
kind of like the way it is for a lot of disabled people. You get squeezed by people who want to control your life, maybe for good reasons, but good intentions, but that you wind up feeling like you don't really have any choices and that other people know better and all that. And when these younger people began to realize that they could spread their wings a little bit, they started to want to do really wild and crazy things, like going to a rock concert and stuff like that, every young person wants to do. But that did not fit in with the nursing home plans at all, because, they're like any other institution. They're run for the institution.
Yeah.
So,
and
go ahead. I'm sorry.
And so to fast forward back to the buses, eventually the ADA came along. There was for a while, ADAPT was protesting every time the American Public Transit Agency showed up.
Exactly. They had the American Public Transit Association, APTA, would have they had several conventions every year. They had a national convention, and then they'd have an Eastern Regional and a Western Regional convention. And in the spring, and the big one was in the fall, and we would go to every one of their national conventions, and then we'd either go to an Eastern or a Western regional convention, and we were protesting against them because they had sued to get the, there used to be rules that said every bus should have a lift, and then APTA sued and got those rules overturned. And so we were protesting them because they were against having lifts on the buses. And so we would go there and basically give them a taste of their own medicine. If we can't get around, neither can you.
I remember very much like what Black Lives Matter was doing on BART many years later in West Oakland and in other systems across the country. But yeah, I remember being in San Francisco in 87 and seeing a public service announcement for one of these on TV, so I dropped by. It never occurred to me that all these people using wheelchairs would end up blocking a street. And then the next year, at the American Public Transit Association, decamped from Montreal. What was that, to try and get away from you?
We never knew why they went there, but I do know that the Montreal system was part of their association. But that was a wild adventure, going up to Canada, crossing the border, not being sure if we'd be able to get over into Canada. We chase them everywhere. In San Francisco, we stop the trolley cars to, you know, call attention to the issue. We went, like I said, up into Montreal for a convention up there, and we went to cities all over the country, wherever they were meeting.
They did all this for free. Just like we do all this for free, but the engineers do not, the power company does not, it does take, Josh does not work in the mailroom for free. And so that's why we need you to whip out the credit card and get the phone, and start punching numbers up on the phone. Yeah.
Yeah, and that is how people moved around to all of these things, was each person with their own bits of cash and a little bit of grassroots fundraising that you were able to do as an organization. And that is what we're trying to do here at KPFA. So let's go back and tell people again what we have to offer. If you become a member today of KPFA, it's not quite like being a member of ADAPT. We're not going to ask you to stand in front of a bus, but we do want you to give us a little help. Then who knows what happens from there.
I mean, it does take a lot to keep a radio station like KPFA on the air. It takes grassroots people who poke their head up, find the sun, and give us a call at 1-800-439-5732. That's 1-800-439-5732, or online securely at kpfa.org. I'd like to thank Alexandria from Hayward for joining us today. Rain from Albuquerque, thank you. Jennifer from Sebastopol, thank you very much. We got Lisa from Oakland. You are so welcome. And thank you, Lisa, for supporting Pushing Limits. Thank you, Susan from Point Arena. And there's more, but wait. No, then there's anonymous folks. But, you know, thank you so much for calling and supporting us here at Pushing Limits. Thank you for supporting KPFA. I don't know of any other station that would just forego the pledge drive to Adrienne, please.
Sorry.
Forego the pledge drive to bring the Senate Judiciary hearings on. Forego it. Because it is important to bring what is happening now to our airwaves. And having you call 1-800-439-5732 and supporting Pushing Limits right now and receive any of the gifts that we have. We have a Pussy Hats by Helga Spisman, which she is an 80-year-old Holocaust survivor activist, turned activist, was never an activist until the orange man in the White House was elected, and then started crocheting, like knitting. They're knit pussy hats. I'm wearing one right now, so you can imagine. It's a beautiful pussy hat.
Yeah, these are similar to the ones worn by Frank Fontana into Phil's, or Time Dailies anyway, on Murphy Brown last night. So these are very much
very
in
similar.
Fashion.
Yes, and for a mere $40 pledge, you can receive your own pussy hats. Or a $60 pledge, you can receive a My Medicare Matters pullover. Well, of course, T-shirts are pullover. They're not really zip.
That's right.
Not zip T-shirts. But a T-shirt, My Medicaid Matters, anywhere from small to triple 3X. And, triple 3X, that's a 9X, not a 9X.
No, it's 3X, 3XL. Extra large, 3XL.
That's for $60 pledge. Or an unapologetically disabled pullover hooded sweatshirt made by...
That's made by Disability Visibility, this fantastic organization that regularly puts out information about people with disabilities. Like every night we see something more going on in our community, and it's due to those folks. And they donated 5 of these to us. So the first 5 people, these are Hanes, extra heavy, just perfect for the winter. And they say, unapologetically disabled across your chest. It's fantastic.
And if you want all 3 of those, $150 would be the going rate for that. And what you're actually getting is disability radio on KPFA. I mean, basically, it is kind of your choice. You are saying we love Pushing Limits. We want Pushing Limits to stay on the air. And we are going for $1,500 this hour, which is a lot of money because we're not the richest folks on the planet. However, all you need to do is give what you can afford. $25 makes you a voting member here at KPFA, and it's important to support us.
Now, I got a My Medicaid Matters t-shirt at an Adapt Action in Washington, D.C. Up, back, and forth Pennsylvania Avenue we went to the back of the White House. So you could still get, at least get back there then. But isn't it just easier to donate to the station? I mean, my knees were practically frozen solid by the end of that.
We just got a message from Jean in Elsa Bronte saying, as an old-time adapter, I send love and admiration to Stephanie and Pushing Limits. Thank you, Jean. Thanks for calling in. Thanks for supporting Pushing Limits. Thanks for supporting KPFA. Join Jean by calling 1-800-439-5732 or going online at kpfa.org. Give anything you can, $25, $40, $60. Some folks don't have the money. You can make up for that. You can give for others who cannot.
Yes, we want to give a shout out to you in your town next time. I let all these other people have all the fun.
And one of the reasons that we chose this particular t-shirt, My Medicaid Matters, in California, My Medicaid is My Medi-Cal. That's what it's called. It's a program. But that is the low-income supplement that the federal government gives to a lot of us with disabilities so that we can have health care. And that was what the Republicans were going after when they went after Obamacare. And that was what ADAPT stood up for. Over and over, day in, day after day, got arrested for and made a huge difference when the Republicans were going after it. What was that, a year ago now? A year ago this summer, yeah. So we really want this. You know, a lot of times you go to the protest, you get the latest thing. Well, this is the latest thing because those Republicans are coming back around. Mm-hmm. As soon as they think they can win in November, they're going to be after our Medicaid again.
And they are. And there are two callers on the line. Why don't you join them right now? Let's get the phone lines ringing off the hook. Let it be a ring of endorsement for Pushing Limits for KPFA in this dark hour. It is dark out there. Let us be the light that shines. 1-800-439-5732.
Yeah, this week they happen to be oppressing women, but fear not, they will move on and start oppressing us again.
Again.
Well, and us who are
and
women.
Come back around.
Yeah, we're going to be double oppressed all the time. Shelley's pussy hat's the same sort of thing. Like, well, wasn't that last year's protest, but no. The Me Too movement and Kavanaugh, here it is again. So thank goodness we have all of this, and now Josh is going to give you the number where you could become part of KPFA and maybe pick up one of these premiums.
1-800-439-5732. 1-800-HEY-KPFA.
Oh, it's Hey KPFA.
Yes.
Hey, KPFA. What do you know about that? KPFA.org. We have three callers on the line. Please join them. 1-800-439-5732. You can also go online at KPFA.org and find something that you like online because there are choices. You have choices here, and we want you to choose Pushing Limits. We want to always have that as a choice on your radio dial.
And I just got to say one last gift that we haven't talked about yet is the gift of membership in the ability to vote in our national and local board elections. We are going to have an election for our local board again coming up right after the national election. So the deadline for becoming a member of KPFA to vote in that election is October 1st. So for $25, you become a member, you give us support, and your vote will matter. And I think it might be time for a station break.
Well, we have four callers on the line. Why don't you join in? 1-800-439-5732.
This is KPFA 94.1 in Berkeley and 89.3. 88.1. KFCF in Fresno, and 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, or online at www.kpfa.org.
And that was Josh Elwood giving us our program ID.
And this is Pushing Limits, KPFA's program by and for people with disabilities.
And that was Mark Romoser.
It is. And somewhere out in the ether is Stephanie Thomas, who has been speaking with us about the early days of ADAPT.
Yeah, let's go back to that.
Can I ask Stephanie a question? Stephanie, this is Shelley. I want to know, because when the cops come in and pull off somebody in a wheelchair to arrest, it does really upset regular folk. So how much of that was a coordinated effort, or did that just happen organically?
I would say that it was a pretty organic thing. I mean, the people felt like it was very important for people who are directly affected to be the spokespeople and the front, you know, the actual what we would call the warriors in the fight for disability rights. So people with disabilities felt very strongly that we needed to be the ones on the line. I've seen disability organizing from some other countries, and I'm always interested to see how many people without any visible disabilities, like students that are supportive and all that, that get involved, and they're a big part of it. But in the beginning, there was even rules that people who are not disabled should not get arrested, because the idea was, there's always this theory that somebody was, you know, kind of putting us up there and pushing us a bunch of pawns. That was the word I was looking for. Thank you. Yes. And that was not the case at all. And one of the things that I thought when I first came to ADAPT that in 1985, one of the things that I thought was the most fantastic about it was that the people that had decided to take this fight to such an extreme limit were often people who had themselves been incarcerated in nursing homes or in other kinds of institutions for people with disabilities. And they had known what the bottom of the barrel life with a disability can be. And they just felt like, you know, we have to take this all the way to the limit. And so many of the people that were there were extremely disabled, but their hearts were the strongest hearts I'd ever seen. And their thinking about disability rights was the clearest I'd ever listened to, because they were just, they had been there. They knew, and they were willing to put their lives on the line for the fight for disability rights. And that was the beauty of it was so strong, I could not resist. I mean, I was kind of a chicken in the beginning. You know, I was like, oh, my goodness, you know, getting arrested. And every time it happens, it's still nerve-wracking. You never know what's going to happen. You don't know if you're going to get locked up for a long time or just get a ticket. You just have to kind of take the step off the cliff and hope for the best. And it works out one way or another, and one of the ways it works out is by everyone working together and supporting each other, and just like people should be supporting KPFA. And when we work together, that's when we really can get things done. But well, I mean, there were people on oxygen, there were people on ventilators, there were people, lots of people in wheelchairs of all types. So, I mean, it was a mishmash. And in fact, if you'd like to see more about it, I'm working on an online museum of ADAPT history that people can go and visit. It's www.adaptmuseum.net. And it's got articles from the past. It's got some videos. It's going to have a lot more over time. But that's and I'm trying to make it accessible too, so people, you know, can access it in all different kinds of ways. And there's, you'll see that, you know, it was all kinds of folks that were involved in the early days, and even today. I mean, when you, if you looked at that protest that you were referring to about the Affordable Care Act, that was Obamacare. That was, you know, all kinds of people were there protesting that for exactly what you said. And those shirts that you have, the My Medicaid Matters shirts, we're going to need those because the deficit that they have run up now, they're not going to be able to maintain their Republican credentials if they don't do something about it. And their plan is to cut basic services for people, health care, attendance services, all of those Medicaid-related services or Medi-Cal-related services are going to be in jeopardy very soon. And you'll need that shirt to show your support for these really critical programs that, you know, really keep people alive and in the community. And that's what really ADAPT was about. You know, after we got the bus part passed, we were like, you know, well, we could sit back and eat bonbons or whatever, but we decided that what was a lot better way to spend our time was to start fighting for national attendance services programs for people so that they could live in the community and not have to be locked up in nursing homes and other institutions. And that was our the kind of next big push that we made. And it was,
and so,
you know,
ADAPT
vital.
Originally stood for Americans Disabled for Accessible Public Transportation. But we went through that in the previous segment. We got accessible public transportation. Now what? Bonbons sound
good.
Well,
then we probably had a couple of those just to celebrate. But then it became American Disabled for Attendant Programs Today.
And I want to talk to you more about that a little bit. But before you leave the history, and by the way, you can get to the ADAPT website, which has that history information museum, through our website, which is pushinglimitsradio.org. But I had heard that one of the reasons ADAPT was so successful in the early days was that it had a lot of military tactics that people were... came maybe from military backgrounds, I'm not sure, and they learned how to move those power wheelchairs in block streets very efficiently, and that was kind of an ethic, you know, sort of a little macho-ness there back in the beginning. Is that a rumor? Is that a national urban legend?
It's kind of an urban legend. I mean, people always talked about us like that, and the transit people love to talk about our military tactics and all that. But really, we were just folks, you know, we did have a plan, but how we did it was we tried to keep it as simple as possible. And we understood that we did have to work together, and we had to sort of sublimate our personal desires and thoughts to the overall plan. But it wasn't like we went on drills and all that kind of thing. It's just that when you do things enough times, you get pretty good at them. And we did, you know, it's not that complicated to block a bus. And you can just show someone how to do it real fast. And then, you know, and so we tried a combination of having a simple plan and also having everybody ready and willing to focus on that one thing. And I think focusing on the single issue of lifts on buses really helped to get people, you know, in rhythm with each other and doing things together. And that all of that really, really helped. And then, you know, chanting keeps you in rhythm together. People who knew how to use wheelchairs, a lot of times when people are not around people in wheelchairs, they don't really understand how it works. And so when you know what you're doing because you do it every day, it looks like you're like this formidable force. And you can be quite intimidating in a motorized wheelchair simply because the other side doesn't have any idea of what you're doing or what your life is like or any of that.
Right. So one more history question, and this is a long one, long-winded one, but how about women in ADAPT? What has that changed? What's been the role of women historically in ADAPT?
Well, I think the role of women in ADAPT has been actually not bad at all. I actually am kind of disappointed with a lot of the female leadership in the disability community generally, because they really failed to recognize the women leaders in ADAPT. There have been many, including myself, and we were very much a part of what was going on and very much a part of making things happen and deciding what should happen and all of that. I think it's one of the most, even though there is kind of a sublimation of yourself to the overall plan and the issue, it's a very egalitarian organization in that all kinds of people become leaders, and the idea is for the leadership to rotate and for local organizations to set things up how they want to set it up, to work on the issues that they want to work on locally, and just, you know, to help support the national issue overall.
What about people of color also in terms of the beginning,
deal,
middle, and end?
Same deal.
Lots of people all the way along?
There have been lots of people of color all the way along. I mean, a lot of people who get stuck in nursing homes and other institutions are people of color with disabilities. And basically a lot of it is an income issue. And lower income people, that's what winds up being their fate. And especially back then in the early days, there wasn't a lot of people. There wasn't a lot of other opportunities for people. So if you couldn't afford your own, attendants or direct care workers or whatever you want to call them, then, you didn't have any other options. And that's who was institutionalized. And that's who was willing to go out on the line and really take things on.
Yeah, I do remember back at that 87 protest around Union Square in SF, people making the obvious but cogent point that Rosa Parks didn't want to go to the back of the bus. We just want to get on the bus.
Well, exactly.
So there is what we call intersectionality going on there between people with disabilities and other oppressed groups.
That's true. Such as people of color.
Yeah.
Where things can combine, where a person combines more than one, if you want to call it label or whatever, more than one persona, that is definitely part of the disability community, because, you know, as we all have said 1,001 times, anyone can get a disability at any time, and eventually everyone will. So there is definitely a crossover. You know, can things be better? Things can always be better in terms of support and all that. And I think that goes both ways, where I think other groups can be more supportive of disability than what they are. But I think that, that it's very, one of the most equal opportunity groups that there is to have a disability and to fight for disability rights. And if you think about not so much ADAPT, but if you just think generally about any social justice issue, there's a disability angle to it. I mean, yep. Whether it's environmental stuff or whatever, there's a disability piece to it.
Yep, we're seeing this right now with the straw man arguments being made against plastic straws, which an environmentalist are annoying pollutants. To someone with a significant physical disability, it means the ability to drink stuff in public.
Well, again, there are other ways to make straws, too. So there's opportunities to be for other ways to make straws. I mean, I know plastic straws are the most accessible.
This is true, but as you well know, no one else is going to bother making a
I don't know, Mark.
An environmental straw for us. So we have to do it ourselves.
Exactly.
I've put this out into people who are makers.
Yeah, we can make straws out of aluminum or glass, and we can, in the same factory, make windmills. There are opportunities for folks with disability. And we can get rich, too. And we can be so thoughtful about the way that we spend our money that we donate back to the community. You know,
like KPFA.
Exactly. Well, and I just wanted to give you a little update. I'd like to thank Audrey from San Francisco for going for the 3-pack. She'd got the pussy hat, the My Medicare Matters T-shirt,
Medicaid.
My Medicaid Matters T-shirt, and the Unapologetically Disabled sweatshirt for $150. You, too, can get one of those by dialing 1-800-439-5732. There is nobody on the line right now. I'd like to thank Deborah from Berkeley for calling in supporting Pushing Limits, Anonymous from Oakland for calling in supporting Pushing Limits, and DB from San Francisco for calling and supporting during this hour. Thank you so much, folks.
That means we've made our match.
We did make our match.
But we have not made our goal for today by a long shot.
And I just want to say, to give you a fun drive update, what are we trying to raise, Josh, this fun drive?
I want to say $575,000.
$575,000. Well, we are nearly at $300,000, and there is 1 week to go for this fun drive.
Week from today.
Yep. So we actually here on Pushing Limits went over the $24,000 mark for the day. We pushed it over, so that's good for us. However, we need you to call right now, 1-800-439-5732, and donate at whatever level you can afford to donate. Support Pushing Limits. Support Voices of Stephanie on the line that represents ADAPT, that is doing the hard work, that is going into, in their wheelchairs, going into Congress and Senate and facing down these white folk men, white men.
Yeah.
With,
of course,
in their chairs and being dragged out by the police. Thank you for calling us at 1-800-439-5732 or going online at kpfa.org and helping us reach the goal of $1,500 this hour.
Yeah, ableism is everywhere. Needless to say, Washington, D.C. is the capital of it, like it is of all such tomfoolery these days. But it's everywhere. Exposure to ADAPT, other than the one rally in 87, came at a training in Memphis where I met Stephanie. That sort of was the genesis of this whole program. Being trained as an ADAPT person, but we found a Subway restaurant in downtown Memphis that had this one little step preventing chair users from getting in. Hmm. Now, I always wondered why the heck anyone who worked in downtown Memphis would be eating at Subway anyway when there's like barbecue and stuff around. But you know, it is a free country. There should be access even to Subway. And so there we were.
Even people with disabilities want to access Subways.
Well, not the Subway, although they do have all this. And that gets us to a point where the New York subways in particular are nowhere near as accessible as buses, but that's another story for another time.
So I promised Stephanie that we would get back to her current project, and I didn't want to get there. So let me give you the numbers, everybody. 1-800-439-5732 or 1-800-HEY-KPFA. Call us. Let us have the rest of this time to talk to Stephanie about the current work they're doing.
Well, we have one caller on the line. Please join the caller so that we can make our $1,500 goal this hour.
Indeed. The point is that after I happened to be holding the bullhorn for whatever reason in front of the Subway, and one of Memphis's finest, no, not Elvis, a policeman, came up, there will be no amplified music. Okay. But don't you know, by the time I got back to California, that particular Subway had become accessible.
Wow.
Right on.
That's right.
Right on, ADAPT.
That's right.
So, Stephanie.
Right on, Mark.
Right on, Mark. Aside from stopping the attack on Obamacare and the Affordable Care Act, you all are working for attendant care in every state. That's a big deal. Tell us about the state of it and where you're at with that campaign.
Well, the different where we have chapters, people are working for attendant services and at the state level. And the thing that happens about that is that every state is very different in their programs, so that it's kind of a more of a localized fight. But if you don't fight at the state level, it isn't going to change. I mean, the way we won the bus thing was transit system by transit system, so that by the time that the ADA passed, over 50% of the systems had agreed to have lifts on buses. And it's the same way with attendance services. But there's also a bill called the Disability Integration Act, which ADAPT is working very hard to get passed, and that would make it a right to have services in the community, which is kind of it's part of the ADA now, but it needs to be strengthened because you have a right in the ADA to get services in the most integrated setting, which is the community. But it needs to be strengthened, and that's why the Disability Integration Act is so important. And there's a big push now to get supporters on for that, and to and so that's a big issue. We're also working on trying to get more accessible, affordable, integrated housing, so that people don't, you know, because one of the biggest barriers for coming out of a nursing home, and the reason some people go in, is because there isn't enough housing that people can afford and that is accessible to them. And we don't want to see you know, more disability ghettos built where it's just all disabled people in the housing and nobody else. We want to see where it's integrated with people with and without disabilities and, you know, just part of the community. So that's a big deal for us. And then also there are just some various different local issues come up for each of the groups. There was a issue that came out of the protest that was recently done in Boston, where there's an institution there that I'm spacing the name of right now, where they
Judge Rottenberg Center.
Electric shock therapy, quote unquote, for people with various kinds of disabilities, such as people who are on the autism spectrum and other disabilities as well. And there are rules that have been written but have not been actually promulgated or put into action that would say that you can't shock people to make them do what you want.
Yeah, I mean, I'm autistic. This kind of hits me right where I live. I mean, you know, suppose I'm in the middle of telling people how wonderful KPFA is and how they really should get on the horn at 1-800-KPFA. And
1-800-439-5732.
And all of a sudden, I get an electric shock. I mean, what's that about?
We have to make
you behave. I'm a Yaley. I partied with Brett Kavanaugh for all I know. You don't need to electric shock me. No, really. I remember going into that same building that is now famous called Lawrence. Never mind.
Right. Yes, it is
shocking.
Outrageous.
That shocking. Was shocking.
Mark is often shocking.
Mark is shocking.
That situation at that institution was incredibly bad, and it's just a measure of some of the other institutions that are around. So we have to let you go, Stephanie, but thank you.
Well, but Stephanie, thank you so much for coming on with us at here at Pushing Limits. And can you just tell folks what an attendant is before you leave?
Yes, that is I will be more than happy to. They are the people that do the direct hands-on assistance to people to help them get dressed, to eat, to take baths or clean their house or whatever. Whatever you kind
drives.
Of you need to live your life. And one of the other issues, I just want to end with this, one of the other issues that we've really worked on is trying to get those people better wages and benefits, because they get paid so badly and there are basically no benefits in their work, and they're so vital to helping people with disabilities live their lives. So that's another big issue for ADAPT.
Yeah, in California, particularly in L.A. County, while the wages here are better than in most other places, just like for most other jobs, the public authorities that each county has that run IHSS, at least down in the South again, are not paying the attendants promptly. You're a working class person. You're working down there for maybe $10, $11 an hour, and then all of a sudden it takes you weeks to get paid. And then you drive by Starbucks exactly. And see that they're hiring, and bam, there's one less attendant.
Very often, fast food and those kind of places pay better than the people who actually help other people live their lives in the community. So we need to put our dollars where our values are, and that goes for attendance, and it also goes for KPFA.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Pushing limits.
Thank you. That's 1-800-439-5732. 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. Join the anonymous donor in Concord and Peter in Fairfax, who just helped us reach our, well, we're not quite at our goal. We have a little bit to go. We need you to call now and join us. If you join at the $40 level, you can get your very own hand-knitted pussy hat by 80-year-old activist Helga Spisman, who took up the knitting needles, and she is a Holocaust survivor as well. And she says, and I've spoken with her, and she says that she's never seen things like this since she was a child, that things have gotten that bad. 1-800-439-5732. And she does have a disability. We wouldn't take it if she didn't. So, yes, she joins us as well. 1-800-439-5732. Get the really terrific My Medicaid Matters t-shirt.
I've never seen it in red.
It's in red.
It's in a different color from the
all the way
itself.
To 3XL. Yep. For a $60 pledge, or you can get the unapologetically disabled sweatshirt, hooded sweatshirt, for a $100 pledge. Throw it all together, $150 for all three. We're waiting for your call, 1-800-439-5732. Join the caller. Oh, that caller's gone. We need to have the phone lines lit up for our phone volunteers.
Yeah, these people are just standing around back there like the Maytag repairmen doing nothing. And we'd like you to join them. As long as they're not going to be doing anything, you might as well hang out with them here at the station.
There you go. Yeah, come on down to Martin Luther King Boulevard, in Berkeley, and give your time. My goodness, thank you so much, Joe from Concord, for joining at a very lovely donation given to KPFA. Grateful.
You know, a lot of people talk about disabled people as inspirational. Oh, she got
you're
up this morning. You're
yep.
so inspirational to me, Mike. Mark, you did it. You stood up from your chair. But when we hear something like what Stephanie's talking about, these stories, these are truly inspirational because these are people who are putting themselves on the line. When you get dragged out of a wheelchair, you don't know what they're going to do, how they're going to treat your body. And your body may be very fragile. So
Joe wrote us a note.
Oh, my gosh. Let's
he
hear
says,
from Joe.
He says, was a water boy and pushing those wheelchairs back in L.A. for 300 wheelchairs for the national annual meeting in 85. Family has been members since 1949 in Antioch. Ooh. Last week attended Mexico City Conference on Disability Rights. Joe, you are awesome. Thank you so much. Join Joe. You are awesome too, listeners. Altogether, our awesomeness goes much better when we are together. When we are connected and we're doing something together like now. 1-800-439-5732.
I wanted to say one thing about becoming a member of KPFA in order to vote in our board elections this winter. KPFA is in trouble because of its national foundation that runs it and has four other stations. We have a loan that is floating the network at this point. It's $4 or $5 million. And the collateral for that loan is our building and also some other buildings around the network. So this election is crucial. And if you want to be part of it, that's the way you can support us is with your vote. So Come in, join us at the $25 level. You can have a vote. 1-800-439-5732 or 800-HEY-KPFA.
Join that caller on the line right now. 1-800-439-5732. KPFA.org.
That should just about do it. Thank you very much to our fabulous guest, Stephanie Thomas. This is Pushing Limits on KPFA Radio.
And thank you, Erica Bridgman, at the helm.
I've got to keep on pushing. Mm-hmm. I can't stop now.